So good day. So in the last lectures, we discussed about some metal alloys. So metal alloys, basically we can classify into two, a non-ferrous alloy and a ferrous alloy. Okay, so last class we discussed about some of the ferrous alloy. In the ferrous alloy, the important, base metal is iron. So we add some impurity or alloy elements into the iron to make a ferrous metal alloy. Okay, so we can classify the ferrous metal alloy into two. First one is steel and second one is cast iron. Okay, and this steel again we can classify into two, that is the plain carbon steel and alloy steel. Okay, alloy steel. So this is the classification of the steel, and from the phase diagram we know theoretically this is 2.14% of carbon. Okay, theoretically from the phase diagram up to 2.14% of carbon we can say that is a steel region, but practically we only add carbon up to 1.4% or 1.5%. Okay, so theoretically we can say up to 2.14% we got a steel material, but practically we only use up to 1.4% because after 1.5% of additional carbon, if we add carbon more than 1.5%, then the steel become very brittle. Okay, it is not usable in most of the engineering application. So we use only up to 1.4 or 1.5% of carbon for making steel. So steel again classified into plain carbon steel. It is low carbon steel. We discuss about that. Then medium carbon steel. Then high carbon steel. High carbon steel. And different types. There are different types of alloy steel. So in case of plain carbon steel, the major alloy element is carbon. Carbon is the major alloy element in case of plain carbon steel. Okay, maybe there are some alloy element, but the percentage of carbon is more. When we consider different types of alloy elements added to the plain carbon steel, the percentage of carbon is more than that of any other alloy element. Maybe we add silicon or molybdenum or phosphorus, any type of alloy element we can add into the plain carbon steel, but the percentage, when we check the percentage carbon will be more. But in case of alloy steel, of course, there is a particular percentage of carbon. It may be, for example, 0.6% of carbon. But we add another alloy element which has higher concentration than that of this carbon. So in case of alloy steel, the major alloy element will be any of the alloy element we discussed about. This is your assignment. These are the 14 types of alloy elements we can add into the steel. Okay, so these 14 different materials concentration will be higher than that of carbon. So that is the case of alloy steel. So based on this, we can classify plain carbon steel and alloy steel. Okay, so that is the first ferrous alloy, and the second ferrous alloy is called cast iron. Second ferrous alloy is called cast iron. Okay. So this is the steel, plain carbon steel and alloy steel. So low carbon steel, 0.3, less than 0.3% of carbon, 0.3 to 0.6, greater than 0.6% of carbon for high carbon steel. Okay. So carbon content is vary. We can say it is vary from 0.05 to 2.1, but practically we only add up to 1.5% of carbon. In case of alloy steel, we have different types of alloy, 14. We can see chromium, nickel, vanadium, molybdenum, tungsten, cobalt, copper, manganese, silicon, phosphorus, sulfur. There are different types of alloy elements we can add into the steel. And here also, in this case also alloy steel, we add carbon content, which is also vary from 0.2 to 1.5%. Okay, and based on the concentration of this alloy element, we can again this classify into low and medium high alloy steels. Okay, so that is the one type of classification of steel. And so that is about one type of ferrous alloy. And next step of ferrous alloy is cast iron. The next step is called cast iron. And in case of cast iron, what is the percentage of carbon? From the phase diagram, it is clear that for cast iron, so this is the phase diagram, and for cast iron, this is the region from 2.14% to 6.70%. So that is the region of cast iron. Okay. So this is the region of cast iron. This is the region of cast iron. 2.14% to 6.70%. And this is the region of steel. This is the region of steel from 0.05 to 2.14% theoretically. Okay. But here also, in case of cast iron also, we are not adding carbon more than 4.3%. Then cast iron become more brittle. It is not useful for any engineering application. So in practical application, we add cast iron only between 2.14 and 4.3%. Okay, so we add carbon between 2.14% and 4.3%. Then we got cast iron for different engineering application. Okay, so that is the next type of ferrous alloy, cast iron. Okay, next type of ferrous alloy, cast iron. Okay, so next we will discuss about this cast iron. There are different types of cast irons are available, and we will discuss about this cast iron in this lecture. Okay, so cast iron, where the carbon content is in the iron is more than 2%. Of course, we know in case of cast iron also the carbon occupy as an industrial alloy element. Okay, so what are the different properties of cast iron? Cast iron has low melting temperature. Okay, it has only 1200 degree Celsius melting temperature, but we know for iron it is 1538 degree Celsius. Okay, and steel, of course, depend upon the carbon composition, it is also has a high melting temperature. But in case of cast iron, it has low melting temperature. So what is the main advantage of this low melting temperature? We can easily melt this cast iron. Because of the low melting temperature, we can easily melt this cast iron, and we can pour the molten metal into the mold for preparing cast product. Okay, we can prepare cast product in the foundry by pouring the molten material of cast iron into this mold. Okay, so cast iron is brittle in nature and has low tensile strength. So from the iron carbon equilibrium diagram, it is clear that this is the eutectoid point. Eutectoid point, and this is the eutectic point. This is 4.3 and 2.14. So when we move from left to right, the carbon content is increasing. Okay, the carbon content is increasing. So when the carbon content increases, what happened? The ferrite, the cement Fe3C will form. Okay, this Fe3C is a brittle material. It's a brittle in nature. So when we move from left to right, even in case of steel also, when we move from left to right, if we increase the carbon composition, so the brittle nature of the material will increase. Okay, so we can say the cast iron is in this region of higher carbon concentration, where we can see more concentration of Fe3C cementate. So we can say that is brittle in nature and it has low tensile strength. Okay, but it has high compressive strength. Cast iron has high compressive strength. So that property is very useful in different applications. For example, we make the foundation for the different machines. Foundations of different machines is prepared using cast iron. So in case of foundation, we know the it is subjected to compressive load. So where we can use cast iron materials because of the high compressive strength. Okay, and is again the ability to absorb vibration or damping capacity. So this property also useful for in the case of machine foundations. Okay, because when we operate any machine, what happen? The vibration will transfer from machine to the ground. Okay, so in between, if we can provide a cast iron base in between the machine and the ground, then this cast iron material absorb all the vibration from the machine. Okay, so that is another advantage of using Cassian for this machine base, for making it the base of the or foundation of the machine. Okay, and it has high heat and corrosion resistance, so high wear resistance. This is an important property. Cassian has high wear resistance, so that property also used in different application. Okay, and have high hardness, and it has good machinability. Yeah, it can easily machine with a higher tool life and with a good surface finish. Okay, it has good machinability and can be cast into intricate shape. We can make very intricate shape, very complex shape using a casting process. How this casting process is performed? First, we melt the casting material, casting material, and the molten material is poured into the, for example, this is a mold, and I am preparing a mold cavity. This is my mold cavity. Okay, so this is my mold cavity, this one. Okay, so this is a very one of one on a complex shape, because here we can see a sharp edges. Okay, so the material should have to flow very easily into the every corner points of this mold cavity. So the material should have high flowability, should flow into the every minute areas of the mold cavity. Then only we got a perfect finished cast product. Okay, so we can make such a intricate shape cast product using casting. So that is another advantage of using casting. Okay, so how this casting is made? Casting is made by the remelting of pig iron, by the remelting of pig iron. So and the making of steel, making of steel and from the iron ore is an interesting area. So you can search on internet to study about how the steel and the castings are made or prepared. Okay, there are different videos are available, and this topic is out of this scope of this syllabus. So I am not explaining how the steel and casting is prepared, but you can search on internet how the steel and casting, what is the manufacturing process of making steel and casting. We use blast furnace and converters for making steel and casting, etc., from the iron ore. Okay, so initially we got rock from the earth crust. Okay, and from the rock, by different process, we got a crude iron ore. Okay, we got crude iron ore after some purification process and some process like a filtration and a powdering, etc. We got from the rock, we got crude iron ore. Okay, and using a blast furnace, we got. This is the furnace which is used to make steel. Okay, and from the blast furnace we got a pig iron extraction. This is called pig iron extraction. So when we process this crude iron ore in a blast furnace, we got a pig iron extraction. So what is a pig iron extraction? So pig iron contain carbon and silicon, phosphorus, magnesium, okay, sulfur, etc. Okay, so when first we treat the crude iron ore in the blast furnace, from this we got a pig iron extraction. Okay, in this pig iron we have carbon, silicon, phosphorus, magnesium, sulfur, etc. All these are impurities. Okay, and the total amount of impurity will be greater than 8%. It will be greater than 8%. The remaining part will be iron. Okay, so these are the impurities. Okay, and from this pig iron we make steel. From the pig iron we make steel, and as well as we produce casting also using converter and other devices. We can make steel and casting. Okay, so from the pig iron, by the remelting of the pig iron along with the substantial quantities of scrap iron and scrap steel. So for any manufacturing process, there will be some scrap. We can use the scrap for along with this pig iron during the time of remelting to produce casting. Okay, so during the melting, various steps are taken to remove the undesirable contaminants like a phosphorus, sulfur, silver, magnesium, silicon. If they, any of the contaminants is undesirable, we can remove that contaminants from the pig iron while producing cast iron. Okay. And depending upon the application, carbon and silicon contents are reduced to desired level. According to the requirement or according to the application, we can adjust the amount of carbon and silicon. Okay, so silicon is one of the essential impurity atom which improve the properties of the cast iron. So we are not completely remove the silicon, we maintain some amount of silicon in the cast iron, and of course the carbon also. Okay, so that is the process of making cast iron. So from the pig iron we make cast iron. So there are different types of cast iron based on the carbon composition and the microstructure. We can classify cast iron into four: gray cast iron, white cast iron, malleable cast iron, and spinoidal graphite cast iron. Okay, so first one is the gray cast iron. In case of gray cast iron, how this gray cast iron is made? By slow cooling process. Okay, by the slow cooling process, the gray cast iron is, so by slowly cooling of the cast iron, we can make this gray cast iron. Okay, by the slow cooling. So what are the composition of this gray cast iron? We have 2.5 to 4%. We can vary the carbon composition 2.5 to 4%, and in that we have silicon, manganese. Manganese maximum 1% is allowed, and sulfur, phosphorus, and remaining part will be iron. Okay, so this is the composition of gray cast iron. Okay, and what is the microstructure? This is the microstructure of the gray cast iron. In this gray cast iron, we can see the white region and some black flake regions. This is called flakes. Okay, this is called graphite flakes. The dark regions we can see in this gray cast iron is called graphite flakes. Okay, it's like a like this we can see the flakes. Okay, and because of this slow cooling, we already said this slow cooling produce gray cast iron. So during this slow cooling, what happened? This graphite flakes are formed. So graphite, we know that that is a free form of carbon. Okay, free form of carbon, that is the graphite. So there is no solid solution, or there is no Fe3C compound in the graphite flakes. Okay, in this graphite flake, it is a free form of carbon. Okay, so this graphite flakes actually distributed in the ferrite or pellite matrix. Okay, so the white region may be ferrite or pellite, depending upon the amount of cooling or rate of cooling, it will be pellite or ferrite. But this dark region, that is the important region in the gray cast iron, so that is a graphite flakes. Okay, the free form of carbon, that is called graphite, and in graphite flakes we can see everywhere in the microstructure of the gray cast iron. So this name is also from the microstructure. When we look on the microstructure, we can see a gray color because of this graphite flake. Okay, that is why the name gray cast iron. Okay, so that is gray cast iron. What are the properties of gray cast iron? We use gray cast iron in different applications, and based on the property, we can use this in different applications. The first one is, it shows only pure strength during tensile loading. It is not good for tensile loading application. Okay, it is show poor strength for tensile loading. But it is very strong in compressive loading. Okay, it is very strong in compressive loading. So anywhere where we apply subjected to tensile load, we can use this gray cast iron. For example, see this. This is the machine tool base. Okay, so this machine tool is foundation is connected using this machine tool base. And this machine tool base is made with the gray cast iron. Okay, there are two important properties which is helpful for this machine tool base. First one is, the when we operate this machine, the severe compressive load will be transferred from machine to the foundation. Okay, Okay, so this gray cast iron will helps to carry the compressive load. So that is the first advantage. Second advantage is this one: when we operate this machine tool, vibration. There will be severe vibration from the machine tool transferred to the foundation. Okay, so it will affect the foundation as well as building when we operate the machine tool. So to remove or to absorb all the vibration, we use a such type of base, gray cast iron base. Okay, so this gray cast iron absorb all the vibration from the machine tool. Okay, so that is the compressive loading. It has a good wear resistance, castability. Castability, I already explained. I can easily flop the molten metal into the intricate shape casting cavity. Okay, it can easily flow anywhere in the casting cavity. Okay, so it has good castability and it has only low melting point. That is the property. Okay, what is the advantage? Graphite act as a chip breaker. This is very important. We got a high surface finish when we machine a gray cast iron material, we will get a high surface finish product after machining. What is the reason? When we machine, you may see the machining process. When we machine, the material from the raw sample is removed from the area like a chip. It is a chip. Okay. The material, when we force the tool against the workpiece, what happened? The material from the workpiece is removed like a chip. Okay. And if this chip is continuous without any breakage, if it is continuous, then the final machined product will be will have a low surface finish. Okay. So it should be break at different length. Okay, it should not be continuous. It should be discontinuous chip. Okay, then we get a high surface finish machined product. Okay, when we use a cast iron, gray cast iron product or workpiece, what happened? When we use a gray cast iron workpiece, inside this gray cast iron, we have a graphite flakes. Okay, we have a graphite flake in the gray cast iron. And this graphite flakes nothing but a carbon or graphite. Okay, so which is very soft in nature compared to the remaining portions. This graphite is very soft. So when the machine tool come contact with this soft graphite, what happened? This at that time the chip will break because this is very soft. So the continuous chip will not be formed. Okay, so when the machine tool when come contact with this soft graphite flake, this chip will break. Okay, so by this breakage of chipping, we got a good surface finish product, cast product. Okay, gray cast iron product. So that is the first advantage. And graphite act as a lubricant during machine. Okay, of course, these carbon particles, the graphite particle flakes act as a lubricant. Okay, so this is very easy for machining. And good dry bearing qualities due to graphite. So we can use this gray cast iron for any bearing application. Because what is the reason? This graphite flakes is very soft in nature. It is not hard. So it is very soft in nature. So this act as a dry bearing in different area where two mating components used application. We can use this gray cast iron as a good dry bearing. Okay, and it has good castability. I already explained what is the castability. Any complicated issue, for example, I want to make this type of product. I am making a mold. A sand mold is prepared with this type of mold cavity, and then I pour the molten gray cast iron into this mold cavity. And this molten gray cast iron should flow into the every corners, every intricate shape of this mold cavity. Then only we got a final product like this. Okay, so it has to flow everywhere. Okay, so this gray cast iron has a capacity of this type of flowability. It can flow anywhere inside the casting. Of course, the shrinkage also good. What is the shrinkage? After casting, when the cast product is solidified, so we pour the molten metal into this cavity. So this cavity is filled with the molten material, and after that, what happened? This molten material solidify. When we cool the this region, what happened? This molten material starts to solidify. So when it starts to solidify, there will be a chance of increase the size of the final mold. Okay, so size may be increase or decrease depending upon the material. Okay, so initially this was the product when we pour the molten metal, but during the solidification, what happened? The molten material during the solidification may expand or contract. Okay, so the size and shape may vary depending upon the expansion and the contraction. So that is called shrinkage. Okay, so this shrinkage is very low in case of gray casting. Okay, so that is also an important advantage during the casting process. So that is the advantage. What is the disadvantage? Cast products are very brittle in nature. Very brittle. So without any indication of the failure, it suddenly break. Okay, so that is brittle in nature. And graphite acts as a void and reduce the strength. So for example, when we this is the gray casting. In this, we can see a graphite flakes. Okay, so this graphite flakes are very soft, very soft. Okay, so when these dislocations or any type of imperfections will not, it can easily pass through these graphite flakes. It can easily be, because this is very soft, so it acts as a bolt. Okay, so it is reduce the strength of these gray casting. And just change in section size will cause the variation in machining characters due to the variation in microstructure. So when we section this, okay, so it will vary the microstructure as well as the machining characters, because the orientation of this or the presence of the graphite flakes will vary depending upon the section. Okay, so that is also another disadvantage. And high strength gray castings are more expensive to produce. We can make a high strength gray casting by adding different impurities, and by using different process, we can make a high strength gray casting, but it's more expensive. Okay, so that is the disadvantages of gray casting. These are the different products made by using gray casting material. Okay, so I already explained machine tool base. The flywheel, this is called flywheel. Okay, this flywheel is actually used to store the energy for a reciprocating engines. Okay, so this flywheel can be made using gray casting. And the sanitary pipes, you may see this type of pipes in the roadside or in your house. So this is a sanitary pipe made by gray casting. And engine head, here also we can use gray casting. Pump housing, we can see the pump housing. This is a cast product, and this is also a gray casting product. Okay, so these are the different applications of gray casting. Any doubt regarding this? Hello. Hello. Okay. Any doubt? Okay. So the next one is white casting. So here this is gray casting, and next one is white casting. So what is the difference between gray casting and white casting? In case of gray casting, we cool the casting very slowly. Okay, when we cool the gray casting very slowly, what happened? The graphite particles are concentrated like a graphite flakes, or carbon particles concentrated in this region like a graphite flakes when we cool very slowly. But when we cool rapidly, and the time for solidification is very small, so graphite flakes do not get a chance to form. Okay, so for the formation of this graphite flake, there is a requirement of time. Okay, it show during the slow cooling process, the graphite flakes got enough time for the formation of such type of flake. But here in the white castane, because of this rapid cooling, the graphite flakes do not get a chance to form. Okay, so in case of white castane, forms with the cementate. Okay, cementate is formed. So the carbon particles, the free form of carbon, react with iron and form Fe3C, and cementate is formed in case of white castane. But in case of gray castane, there is no such cementate formation. The graphite actually in the or carbon is in the free form, which is called graphite, and it is like a flake because of this slow cooling. But is here there is no enough time for formation of these graphite flakes. So in this we can see Fe3C. Okay, so here this is the composition: carbon, silicon, manganese, and its percentage is given, and it can vary in this range, and remaining particles are iron. Okay, so this is the composition of the white castane. So here in the carbon is present in the combined form Fe3C cementate. Okay, so in white castane, this is the very important for white castane. Here in white castane, carbon is present in the form of Fe3C cementate, but in this case carbon is present in the free form of graphite. So that is the difference between white castane and gray castane. And here it is very hard and brittle. The miscibility is poor. Here the miscibility is poor because of the brittle nature. Okay, but it has a good wear resistance and a compressive strength like gray castane. And it is used in different applications like mining shovels. We can see the shovel of this a big machinery, okay, like a JCB shovels. We can use a white castane for making this mining shovels. And rollers, we already discussed what is rolling process in the last class. So in the rolling process we use rollers, and this rollers can be made using white castane. And the rail brake shoe, we can see the brake shoe here. Okay, so brake shoe is actually force against the wheel for stopping the wheel. Okay, so here the brake shoe should have a high wear resistance. Okay, so this white castane has a very good wear resistance, so we can use white castane for making the brake shoe. Okay, and of course the liner in the machinery for processing abrasive materials also we use white castane. So these are the different applications. Another type of castane is called malleable castane. Malleable castane. Okay, and again it is made from the white castane. Okay, the malleable castane is made from the, after preparing the white castane, from the white castane we make the malleable castane, but with the improved miscibility. The main problem of this white castane is the miscibility is poor. Okay, so we can overcome this property by making malleable castane which is made from white castane. How this white malleable castane is prepared? It's prepared by reheating white castanes to 927 degrees Celsius for a long period of time in the presence of material containing oxygen such as iron oxide. Okay, that is the making procedure of the white castane, sorry, malleable castane. So we heat the white castane for a longer period of time in the temperature of 927 degrees Celsius in the presence of any oxygen containing material. It may be iron oxide or aluminum oxide, any type of oxygen containing material in the presence of that material. So what happened during the heating time? At this elevated temperature, the cementate which is already present in the white castane, okay, the cementate is present in the white castane. So when we heat the white castane for a longer period of time, what can happen? This Fe3C decomposes into ferrite and free carbon. Okay, so Fe3C is decomposed into ferrite and free carbon. So what happened in case of Fe3C, that is a compound, it is separated into ferrite. Ferrite means is solid solution. Carbon particles is interstitially occupied in the ferrite, and the remaining carbon particles from the Fe3C in the free form. Okay, when we heat in under high temperature. Upon cooling, the combined carbon further decomposes into very small compact particles instead of flakes like a graphite in the gray casting. So during the cooling time, what happened? These free carbon particles is actually decomposed into very small particles. Very small particles. It is not like flake. It is not like this flake. Here in this gray casting, the free carbon particles is like a flake. But here, the carbon particles is like a actually very small compact particles. So that is the shape of the particles present in the malleable casting. Okay, so the free carbon referred to as a tempered carbon, and this process is called malleablizing. Okay, and this is the composition is almost same to this white casting and the gray casting. The composition almost same, and the carbon is called tempered carbon packets. This carbon particles present in the free carbon particles present in the malleable casting is called tempered carbon packets. Okay, so the three difference here in this carbon is in the free form, it's like a flake nature, flake shape. Okay, in gray casting, but in this white casting, the carbon is not in the free form, it is like a compound Fe3C cementate. Okay, and but here also the carbon is in the free form, but this carbon not in the flake nature, but it is in the tempered carbon packets. It's like a tempered carbon packets. The carbon particles are present in the ferrite. So this is the microstructure. The ferrite, that is a white color, and the graphite is black, and it is a very small particles, clustered particles we can see in the microstructure of the malleable casting. So what are the important properties of the malleable casting? It has a good mechanical and physical properties, good vibration and wear resistance property, used for making drum, crankshaft, crankshaft and camshaft, etc. Okay, so that is malleable casting. It has good, excellent machinability, significant ductility, and good shock resistance property. So it can carry impact loads. Okay, can carry impact load. That is why it has good shock resistance. But disadvantage, malleable casting undergo excessive shrinkage during solidification. So this is a bigger disadvantage. I already explained what is shrinkage during the solidification of the casting process. What happened? This molten material during the solidification may expand or contract. So what happened? When it expand or contract, the size of and shape of the final casting product will be greater than or less than that of the mold cavity. So we have to provide a shrinkage elements for this mold cavity to get a final product with the final dimensions. Okay, so this is the main problem of malleable casting, shrinkage. Okay, so how can we overcome? Either we can provide a shrinkage elements in the mold cavity, or we can provide some feeders. Runners and rises are different feeders we can provide in the casting to avoid the shrinkage. Okay, and there are different applications for this malleable casting. The universal joint yokes, this is the universal joint. You can see in the back side of the vehicles, this is differential. Universal jock joint, that is a universal joint. It is a flexible joint where a one component yoke is made using the malleable casting. And transmission gears, different types of transmission, bevel gear, helical gears, different gears can be made using malleable casting. And differential case can be made using malleable casting. Differential case, this is the differential you can see in the back side of the vehicles. Differential, and its case is made, made using malleable casting. Crankshaft and its hubs are made, can be made. Flanges, different flanges is used to for connection, that is made using malleable casting. Different pipe fittings, you can see a pipe fitting here, this can be made using malleable casting. And different marine and other heavy duty applications we can use this malleable casting. So these are the applications of malleable casting. Okay, so study the microstructure and important applications and the properties of the malleable casting also. The final one is the spheroidal or graphite casting. Spheroidal or graphite casting. Okay, or another name is ductile castin or nodular castin or spheroidal graphite castin. Okay, so what is important characteristics of this spheroidal graphite castin? In case of this spheroidal graphite castin, the graphite is present in the form of, here also a free form of carbon. In graphite form is present in the spheroidal graphite castin, similar to this malleable castin and gray castin. The free form of carbon, that is graphite, present in gray castin, it is like a flake. In the malleable castin, it is like a tempered carbon packets. And in case of ductile or spheroidal graphite castin, it is like a spheroidal nodules. It's like a, what is the shape? It is like a spheroidal nodules rather than the flakes, or inhibiting the creation of cracks and providing the enhanced ductility that gives the alloy's name. So it has the name of ductile graphite castin. And how this name came? This is because of the spheroidal nodules. We can see this. See this, almost spherical. We already studied the spheroidal shape microstructure of the steel, spheroidal microstructure. So in case of spheroidal microstructure, the particles are present like a sphere. Okay, so here we can see graphite particles are like a sphere or nodules in the ferrite matrix. Okay, or in the perlite matrix. Okay, so this type of microstructure we can see in the spheroidal graphite castin. So the free form of carbon graphite is present like a spheroidal nodules. Okay. Okay, so we can see the microstructure. So this type of microstructure gives higher ductility for the castin. Of course, the castin is a brittle material, but this type of graphite carbon particles present in the castin gives higher ductility compared to all other three castin. This has higher ductility. Okay, so magnesium, selenium, calcium and other spheroidizing elements are added in very small quantity. Okay, so when we add during the molten stage, we add magnesium or selenium or calcium into the molten material. So into this molten castin, we have a molten castin. In this we add magnesium. When we add magnesium, what happened? This molten castin in which is in close with these magnesium particles, initially solidify here. So in this region, a nucleation site will be generated. Okay, so this material, magnesium, selenium and calcium, etc., create a nucleation sites. Okay, and this nucleation sites, after grain growth, we got a spheroidal graphite microstructure. Okay, so these are the different nucleation sites actually at the center of all the nodular graphite nodules. We can see a magnesium or calcium like alloys. Okay, so this is the alloy elements are injected into the mold before pouring. So we inject the alloy elements like magnesium or calcium, etc., and this is distributed in the molten material and act as a nucleation site. Okay, and here the carbon particles are present in the form of spheroids or nodules. We can see the spheroids or nodules, almost spherical shape. So this spheroidal shape actually gives the ductile nature of this graphite castin. And this is the composition, and it can be used for oil well pumps, automobile industry, aerospace application. Everywhere we can use this ductile castin. Okay, so here we can see engine connecting rod we can make using this castin. Truck axles can be made, front wheel spindle supports can be made, disc brake capillaries can be, sorry, calipers can be made using this ductile castin. Suspension system, power transmission yokes, the castin pipes, etc., can be made using ductile castin. It has good ductility compared to all other three castin. Here only we can see the ductility. All other eyes are brittle in nature. Okay, malleable, gray, white castins are brittle in nature, but this white, this ductile castin is very ductile in nature. It has high machinability, high wear resistance. It can be forged. After casting process, to get any integrated shape, we can use the secondary manufacturing process like a forge. So that is the next one. So this is the three important points of the classification of cast iron. Here we have a flake-like nature of free carbon particles in the microstructure. And here we have, in this white cast iron, we have Fe3C particles. There is no free form of carbon present. Here we can only see the cementate particles. And here we, again, we can see the free form of carbon particles, which is like a tempered carbon particles, tinny combat particles. We can see carbon graphite is in the tinny or small combat particles. Okay, that is called tempered carbon packets again. And here in this fourth case, we can see the carbon free form of carbon like a nodules or spheroids shape. So that is, that microstructure gives different properties for the four types of cast iron. So that is the classification of cast iron and its properties. Any doubt? Any doubt in this?
No, sir.
Yes? Getilla?
No, sir.
Okay, now. ടോപ്പിക്സ് കുറച്ച് ഒന്ന് ഓർമ്മയിലിരിക്കാൻ ബുദ്ധിമുട്ടുണ്ടാകും, കാരണം ഇതിലെ ഡിഫറെന്റ് അലോയ് എലമെന്റ്സ് വരുന്നുണ്ട്, കൂടാതെ അതിന്റെ പ്രോപ്പർട്ടീസ് എല്ലാം വേരി ചെയ്യും. സോ കുറച്ചെല്ലാം അത് പഠിക്കുക. അതായത് ഇപ്പൊ ഇതിന്റെ ഈ കാസ്റ്റ് ചെയിൻ ആണെങ്കിൽ തന്നെ അതിന്റെ മൈക്രോസ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സിൽ ഉണ്ടാകുന്ന നാലിനത്തിലുള്ള ഡിഫറൻസ്, അതാണ് മെയിൻ ഇമ്പോർട്ടന്റ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഇതിലെ പോയിന്റ്സ്. പിന്നെ ഓഫ്കോഴ്സ് കാസ്റ്റ് ചെയിൻ്റെ ഒരു ബേസിക് പ്രോപ്പർട്ടീസ് ഉണ്ട്. ഓക്കെ, വിയർ റെസിസ്റ്റൻസ്, ബ്രിട്ടിൽനെസ്, ഷോക്ക് അബ്സോർബിങ് കപ്പാസിറ്റീസ്, ഹൈ കംപ്രസീവ് സ്ട്രെങ്ത്, ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള ഡിഫറെന്റ് പ്രോപ്പർട്ടീസ് ഓൾമോസ്റ്റ് സെയിം ആണ്. ഓക്കെ, സോ അതൊക്കെയും പഠിക്കുക കേട്ടോ. പിന്നെ ഹൗ ദീസ് ഫോർ ടൈപ്സ് ആർ ഡിഫറെന്റ് ബേസ്ഡ് ഓൺ ദ മൈക്രോസ്ട്രക്ചർ, ആ കാര്യങ്ങളും പഠിക്കുക. ഓക്കെ, ആപ്ലിക്കേഷൻ ഇസ് ഓൾമോസ്റ്റ് സെയിം. ഓൾമോസ്റ്റ് എല്ലാ ആപ്ലിക്കേഷൻസിലും നമുക്ക് ഈ നാല് ടൈപ്പും യൂസ് ചെയ്യാം. ഓൾമോസ്റ്റ് സെയിം പ്രോപ്പർട്ടീസാണ്. Okay, any doubt? Okay, le. Next topic it pokade.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so next one is non-ferrous alloys. Non-ferrous alloy. So we already discussed all the ferrous alloys. That means the alloy which containing major base element of iron. Iron is the main base element. In case of cast iron, alloy steel or low carbon steel, anywhere the main base element is iron. And again, we classify into steel and cast iron based on the percentage of carbon. Next, we are going to discuss about non-ferrous alloys. Non-ferrous alloys. In the case of non-ferrous alloys, the iron is not the base metal. Iron is not the base metal. Okay, so in case of non-ferrous alloy, there are different base metal, and we can classify into low alloy metals and high alloy metals. Okay, and here we can see the non-ferrous base metal may be aluminium, zinc, titanium, copper, nickel, cobalt, magnesium. So there are different types of other metals. Which is the base metal in case of non-ferrous? Ferrous means iron. Ferrous means iron, Fe. Okay, so non-ferrous case, we have different other metals as a base metal. Okay, that is non-ferrous metal. So what is the material composition of this beverage can? Anyone? How this beverage can is made, or what is the material used to make this beverage can?
Aluminium.
It's made up of aluminium. Any other answer? So what is the main important property of this beverage can? Or characteristics of this beverage can?
Small weight.
Yeah, it has a very low weight, lightweight material ആണ് ഇതിൽ യൂസ് ചെയ്തിരിക്കുന്നത്. അനദർ വൺ, എന്താ?
Crush.
Yeah, it can easily crush. It can easily crush. That means how this crushing possible? When we check the thickness of this can, it is very thin. The thickness is very, it is a very thin sheet. Right. So it should be very malleable. Malleability should be very high. Then only the material can be made like a thin sheet. Okay. So the material which is used to make this can is a very malleable material. Yeah, ductile. And there are two types of. So what is the ductile and ductility and the malleability difference? What is the difference between ductility and malleability? For example, I have a raw material. How can I say this material is ductile, or how can I say it is malleable? So if this material can be easily converted into thin wires, okay, if this raw material can be easily converted to thin wire, then we can say that is a ductile material. For example, how can we make this thin wire? This is a very small opening. In this area, I am filling the raw material and I push this material, I pull this material through the opening, then the material is converted to thin wire. Okay, so when I can make a thin wire from this material, then I can say this material is a ductile material. And how can you say it is malleable, or malleability is high? It can be converted to during hammering process, by hammering process or by applying any compressive load. I can convert, if I can convert this raw material, and this is my raw material, if I can convert this raw material into very thin sheet. Okay, I convert this into very thin sheet by a hammering process or by pressing process, then I can say this is a malleable material. Okay, so here, for any particular application, if you require to convert a material into very thin sheet, then you have to use a malleable material. Okay, so this is a malleable material. And one of the another important application is the corrosion resistance. Okay, because the cork material is a highly acidic in nature. Okay, the cola is a very highly acidic. So when this acidic material is come contact with any type of ferrous material, it's like a maybe steel or cast iron, any type of ferrous material, what happened? There will be a chance for corrosion or rusting. So we have to use a material with a very high corrosion resistance. Okay, otherwise, after 1 month or 2 months, the material starts to rust. Inside portion starts to rust. So that is another problem of face when we use a ferrous material. So here we are using an aluminum alloy for making this beverage can. Okay, so the aluminum base for beverage can consists mostly of aluminum, and it contains other material also. They are typically 1% of magnesium. Base metal is aluminum. Other than aluminum, we can use along with aluminum, we can use magnesium, manganese, iron. This is only very small quantity. Iron is used, but it is very small quantity. Okay, and silicon, copper, etc. can be used. Okay, in case of non-ferrous alloys also, there will be a presence of iron, but that is not a, iron is not a major component or major material in this alloy. Or base metal is not iron. Okay, but in case of ferrous alloy, the base metal, the major component or major composition will be iron. So that is the difference. So here also iron is present, and the larger portion of aluminum is used in the beverage can industry is derived from the recycled material. Okay, it is we can develop from the recycled material also. So here aluminum is the base material. So aluminum is a non-ferrous material. Okay, so you can search on this state madehow.com. We can see different manufacturing process, how different products are developed or made. Okay, you can search on this. You got different ideas or how different products are made. All videos, videos and materials are available from this site. Okay, so what is the limitation of ferrous alloy? Iron based alloys, high density. So we cannot use this ferrous alloy here, because when we make this can using a ferrous alloy, it will have high weight. It will not be lightweight. It will be heavy weight. Okay, so we cannot use that, because it has a ferrous alloy has very high density and comparatively low electrical conductivity. Ferrous alloys or ferrous material has low electrical conductivity. Most of our products, we need a material with a high electrical and a thermal conductivity. So where we use non-ferrous material. Another limitation is the inherent susceptibility to corrosion in certain images. That is the main problem of the ferrous material. Main problem, because everywhere when we use steel or cast iron or iron based material, the corrosion is a big problem. Okay, so this actually inhibits the long life of the product. Okay, after some time, they start to rust. So that is the main three problems of the ferrous alloy. To overcome these three problems, we are using non-ferrous alloys. Non-ferrous alloys. Non-ferrous alloys are classified into light alloys. That means the density. All these alloys are very light in nature, light materials. And of course, there are some heavy alloys also with a higher density. Okay, so we can classify into light alloys and heavy alloy. Aluminum, zinc, titanium, magnesium, everything comes under this light alloy. Heavy alloys are copper, nickel, cobalt, etc. Okay. Ungur break vano. Break vano. 12 mani vare edikkunna. Veni oru 10:15 avana oru break edutho. 5 minutes.
Okay sir.
പോയിട്ടിപ്പോ
തന്നെ വന്നോട്ടോ, ഞാൻ ക്ലാസ് കണ്ടിന്യൂ ചെയ്യാം. ആർക്കെങ്കിലും ഡൗട്ട്സ് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ചോദിച്ചോട്ടോ ഇതിന്റെ ഇടയ്ക്ക്.
പത്തി ഇരുപത്തഞ്ചേ കയറിയായിരുന്നു.